year since the pandemic, over 1.1 million riders have had a great experience on the MTA, connected them to their jobs, their families, recreation, and sometimes on a weekend, that's Sunday brunch. The Six Line moved more riders than the LIRR and Metro North combined. I have one thing to say. The subway is roaring back, and I thank the thousands of workers who persevered during the toughest days, the dark days of the pandemic, who are still here on the job every single day. So let's give a round of applause to our entire MTA workforce. Thank you. So grateful for all of you. And today, many of our riders are going to have a chance to experience what they call the open gangway car. Now, what's that? Well, you don't know it because this will be the first time ever these cars have been deployed in North America. Now, if you travel across the pond, you go to Europe, you go to London, you're going to see this experience or feel this, but we've never done this before in North America. So as that place of firsts, you're seeing another first right here in New York. And so I want to recognize some of the individuals who are here who've made this happen, who are so dedicated to improving the service, the quality of the experience for our riders, starting with MTA Chair and CEO Jana Lieber. Thank you for being that transformational force that we have needed for such a long time. I'm grateful to you and your leadership. NYPD Chief of Transit Michael Kemper. Michael, thank you so much, Chief, for all you do to make our subway safer, especially during some really challenging years and working so closely with our MTA leadership to get the results we need. Our MTA Chief Disability Officer, Kumel Arroyo, is here as well. Thank you. Thank you. Appreciate all you do. Our Federal Transit Administration Regional 2, Michael Collada, Regional Administrator. Thank you, Michael. Thank you. Councilmember Carmen De La Rosa, whose district we're in. Thank you, Councilmember. And also our partners in Congress. We're represented here by Adriano Espaillat. I've been in this neighborhood many times. We were here down the block a little bit a while ago to announce the Public Theater, where we had Lin-Manuel Miranda and his family to create something special. So I was walking these blocks not that long ago with our congressmen, also our leaders, Senators Gillibrand, and of course our Majority Leader Chuck Schumer, who are very instrumental in the Biden administration getting the money back here to make sure this happens. So this is the third year we're putting a real spotlight on our subways, making sure that they're safer, improve accessibility, and to give riders, as I said, a better experience. That's our job. And last year, we halted the upward trend of crime. You saw it going up and up and up. People were too afraid to take the subway. That dynamic has changed dramatically. It is now down not only is it not going up, it's down 2.6%. And that's even 9% lower than we had just a few years ago in 2017. Now, I talk about this because we've also seen a huge drop in the violent crimes, the ones that frighten people. Murders on the subway down 50%. Arrests and summons, which means the perpetrators are getting caught, are also up 50%. So violent crime is down. And people are reporting on our surveys that they're feeling better about the subway experience overall. So we want to make sure that good feelings, that the good times keep rolling. And that's what we're doing by launching these new cars on the C train. If you've not been on it, we're going to take a trip in a few minutes. You can actually move seamlessly from one car to the other. Think about that. You're not trapped. You want to have a different experience. You can get up and move around. You don't get claustrophobic. If you see someone who looks more interesting to talk to somewhere else, just get up and wander around. It also closes the dangerous gap where young people have been harmed and others have fallen through this gap and some loss of life because of the subway surfing, which has become popular. So we're making sure that we're smart about our technologies but also improving the experience. They're also more spacious. Wider doors. Wheelchair accessibility is easier when there's more space to go in and out. It just makes sense. And so you can get out, your commutes can be easier. Also, these new cars have security cameras already built in. Why that is so important? First of all, it's called a security camera. It gives people a sense of security. Every car has at least two cameras that people know that when something's going on that makes them uncomfortable, there's somebody aware of it. And that's a great deterrent, but it also gives people that sense of comfort. You know, the police can actually see what's going on if necessary and respond quicker. So We're not waiting just for these cars to come on. You heard me talk about cameras multiple times. I was with Mayor Adams on two different occasions, usually this time of year. We talk about our initiatives for the upcoming year. We talked about our Cops, Camera, and Care initiative. We talked about, we got together in September 2022, and I said, we need more cameras on the cars. And so we stood there and said, that's our goal. We currently have 14,000 cameras throughout the system. Those are in the stations as well. And we have 2,400 on subway cars. Now, 2,400 already, that's up from zero. We started with zero. Now we have 2,400 cameras. And we have 33,000 more per quarter. We're installing 33 cameras a day. So by the end of this year, because I said it had to be done sooner, remember, Jano?
Yeah.
Okay. I was told a couple, 3 years, maybe four. Jano got it done. So we're going to have doubled the number of cameras in our transit system to nearly 30,000 on all new trains and also our existing trains. So you remember April 2022, I remember it vividly, when 29 people were shot on our train. And there was a problem because some of the cameras weren't functioning. Not all the areas were able to be under surveillance of cameras. And so we said that that's not acceptable. So we changed that dynamic to enhance the security and make sure that people are aware of them as well. Also, we've had subway footage camera play a role in investigation of a shooting in Bed-Stuy, which two New Yorkers were injured. Again, the cameras can lead us to the perpetrator and make sure that they get the consequences they're supposed to and not get away with it. We also helped joyriders be investigated on a train that was stolen in Forest Hills not that long ago. So our cameras are making a difference, but not just on the criminal front. Many of our riders who are regulars have experienced seeing people who are homeless, who have mental health challenges, suffering from addiction, and we know that the subway trains become a refuge for them out from the elements. It's very common. So this is why we want to make sure that we also continue focusing intensely on mental health services. State investment in mental health is up exponentially, up over 45%, up from $3.3 billion in 2022 to over $4.8 billion. And where is that money going? It's going into our subway trains as well. And this is something that the mayor and I are very much committed to. And across New York City, we're investing over $20 million in our SOS operations, our safe operation supports. And what this is, if you've seen these individuals, they're so dedicated. They're wearing the purple jackets. It says SOS on the back. I've walked their beats with them. I've seen them interact with people. People that have made a decision that they're going to continue unable to take care of themselves, that they're going to stay in the subways until someone with compassion and understanding and the training can help wrap around them and make them feel safe enough to go somewhere else. We've been so successful. It's not a one day someone leaves and they come back the next day. We're talking about the long-term homeless are now finding places to find a different experience. Our teams have had over 15,000 encounters with these individuals since they started. We launched this together. It's great. It's having a great success, and we're really proud of that. The objective is to make sure that they end up in housing, and that's what we're focusing on as well. So bottom line is, subway keeps the city moving. I can't imagine the city without it. It would not be as vibrant, it would not be as fast-paced, it would not be New York City. Our entire region's economy depends on it. And also, I want to say one more time, that's why initiatives like congestion pricing are so important. We have projects we want to fund. We want to finish the Second Avenue subway instead of talking about it for generations like has always happened. We want new ideas like the Interbureau Express because people are not coming into Manhattan every day. They're going from Manhattan, they're going from Queens to Brooklyn and vice versa. They deserve to have world-class transportation. So we want to make sure that we can properly fund our five-year capital plan, and that hinges on the continuation of the plan to go forward with congestion pricing without further delays. So the future is just on the tracks. I'm looking forward to taking the ride and trying out this new experience. We're still in a trial period. We're going to be talking about what that's all about in the next couple minutes, and I'll have Jano address that as well. But I want to thank everyone for being here to witness this new chapter in the future of transportation in New York City. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Governor. When you became governor a couple years ago, people said, she's from Buffalo, she's from upstate. What does she know about transit? And Who would have thought it would take a governor from Buffalo to make sure that we have an MTA that is fully funded for 5 years, that has a robust capital program, is rolling out innovations like we're seeing behind us, that is dealing with the, you know, the mental health crisis and the way it impacts on our public space. Thank you, Governor, for being MTA riders' greatest friend. Got to give her a hand, folks. Listen, it's great to have all of you here to celebrate the introduction of these new train cars. We're always, when we celebrate, we also thank our partners. And that's why, as the governor said, we're acknowledging the Federal Transit Administration, who funds new train cars. The federal government, especially under the Biden infrastructure law, is making so much possible. And our partners at the NYPD, who are making the subway and all of our mass transit and all of our public space feel safer so that we can get back to where we were before the pandemic, which the governor is leading the way on. Because of your leadership, Governor, in making sure, as I said, that the MTA is funded and your determination to have riders be safe, we are a new MTA that is growing ridership again and again and again, bringing people back to their pre-pandemic lives and seeing the revival of New York, but we're also taking on the big issues. New York is the mass transit capital of North America. Sometimes I push it and think it's the mass transit capital of the world. Our business model, though, this is New York. Our business model is moving lots of people around to make possible the density that is the essence of New York and what makes us an economic powerhouse. It's all those people being able to get together and do creative thinking and to create economic activity, and only mass transit makes it possible. Wouldn't be possible otherwise. Introducing these cars is going to help with these goals, as the governor said, with open gangways spreading out the crowds and more room by the doors, we're going to be able to get people on and off trains much faster. And that includes our disabled New Yorkers who deserve to be able to easily move. We're making the subway stations more accessible, 100 miles an hour under Governor Hochul. Now we're making it easier for folks who are moving around in wheelchairs and otherwise and with other mobility aids to get on and off trains. Faster loading and unloading. And now, because these cars are not only equipped with the cameras the governor talked about, but also with modern signaling technology, these are the cars that are going to enable us to put modern signals in effect on the whole A train. We've been working on it piece by piece, but that will mean much more reliable service for A and C train riders, because you can run many more cars. You can run cars much closer together safely when you have a modern signaling operation. And that's what also these cars enable. Now, that also depends on us finishing the resignaling project, which it's no secret, as the governor has acknowledged, is waiting for congestion pricing. It's not just Second Avenue subway and all those additional accessible stations that need to be funded by congestion pricing. It's modern signaling so folks in Far Rockaway and Washington Heights and Brownsville can have the same quality of service as folks on the L train have. That's what's at stake in congestion pricing. Listen, everything we've done at MTA comes down to getting more New Yorkers to use mass transit, which is the fastest, greenest, and most affordable way to get around. And just to tick off a few of the highlights that we've accomplished under Governor Hochul, increasing subway service on 11 lines, thanks to your budget last year. Growing Long Island Railroad service by 40% since Grand Central Madison opened. Surging accessibility projects, 25 in the last 3 years, never been done at that pace. Doing a borough-by-borough bus redesign so we can get a lot more bus service and faster bus service for New Yorkers and get them around their neighborhoods. And, of course, those big system expansion projects, Second Avenue Subway, but also the governor's beloved Interborough Express, the IBX that will connect Brooklyn and Queens in a major way, passive travel that are not available now. This is a golden age in mass transit under Kathy Hochul. There is nothing that gives you a better taste of the future and what's coming and what we can deliver than the train we're about to board together. Thank you. And with that, I think we're going to just take some questions, am I correct? And move on to the celebration. Thank you. A final acknowledgement that I should have made at the outset is my brother, Rich Davey, who runs New York City Transit. And all the stuff we do to operate New York City Transit and build this incredible institution is going great guns under Rich. So thank you, Rich, for all you do. Governor.
First question today is from Andrew Siff back there of WNBC. Andrew.
My question is about the open gangway train. You already have the wider doors on the R211s on the A train for the faster boarding. So what should riders think about these open gangway trains? Is it a novelty? You're just going to have two of them in the system? What will they gain out of the experience?
Well, first of all, more people can get on more quickly. So if you're a commuter and you're supposed to be work at a certain time, every minute matters. So it's ease of accessibility. I mean, I've taken the subway many times, and you get jostled around heading in the door because it's narrow. You know, there's that tight squeeze. We're making it a little wider. Just think about the experience of having a little more breathing room, getting on and off, but it is quicker. And it's critically important to me that we have accessibility for people in wheelchairs who need extra minutes. So it's not a stressful moment for them when they're not sure if the door is going to stay open long enough that they can fit in there. So I look at it as an enhanced customer experience, and also just the idea of not being in the one car that you enter. I mean, you make a quick decision. Which car am I going to go in? It's a split decision. And you may think, like, it's more crowded than I thought. You know, it's something's bothering me about this one. I'm not really excited about this. You might just say, I'd like to just go see what else is down the way. It might be more seating. Might be more open space. So it allows people to make that decision on their own. You're not trapped and confined and conscribed to your first decision. You have more options. So I think psychologically, it just improves the experience for the riders overall. Is there anything else you want to add to that?
All right, next question is Kimberly Richardson back there in the mezzanine from Channel 7 Eyewitness News.
Quick question. How many of these trains are going to be in service? And from what I understand, you're banking on congestion pricing to become a reality, the money from that to expand. What if it doesn't?
Oh, it'll happen. It'll happen. I mean, we get sued every day. I say get in line behind the cannabis people, get in line. I mean, it's just our reality. So people have a right to sue, but we have gone through thousands and thousands of hours and pages of environmental review. We've worked with the federal government, made all the thousands of adjustments. We have done everything possible to bring this to reality. Again, change is hard for people, but we talk about London having the other type of cars. They have a different experience. They are not as congested. They're down about 20% because they made a decision that said the quality of life in our city matters, and the fact that people on our streets cannot even move, they're paralyzed. And what scares me when a fire truck or an ambulance can't get through because the congestion is so intense. I mean, the joy of living in New York is all the people. It's fascinating. But let's do something smart for the future that says we're going to protect the environment, we're going to make sure that there's public safety, and thirdly, this is good for making sure we have the resources to invest to make it an even better system so more people want to take it. First part of your question was about how many, do you want to answer that?
It's two train sets, and we're really just, the point is to check, never has this been done in New York before, and there are a lot of operational issues, so the goal is to really test this out to see how the public reacts, whether they do, as the governor says, take advantage of the opportunity to spread out, have a little less crowding, and have a better experience, but also to deal with the operating issues, which are really complicated, because sometimes we close down cars based on operational issues, so we're trying to use these first couple trains to test it out.
All right, we've got Evan Simcoe-Bednarski there from the New York Daily News. Evan.
Governor Geno, I've got a question for the C train riders, of which I count myself. These are two trains. It's by my count, it's going to be at least a year or so before the option arises to order more of this train. Are there going to be additional standard R211s put into service on the C after these go through?
Evan, I want to make sure I give you accurate information, but the idea is these are B division cars that are going to be put. We've been using the R211s heavily on the A line, and I would have every expectation that the C, which shares so much trackage and station and terminal operations, would be benefiting. Governor, close your ears. Hey, the C train needs to get a lot better. We all know that. And every day, Rich will confirm, we talk about the IND, old-time lingo, about A, B, C, D. Those lines for people who depend on mass transit do need to get better, and they need to get more service, and these trains are part of that story.
All right, we got time for one more. Samantha Liebman right there from New York One. Sam.
Two questions. Just explain why these can't run on the A line and when that's coming, if it's coming. And also maybe Chief Kemper can talk about the subway surfing aspect, how this could help possibly with that.
So as you're aware, subway surfing is a big concern of ours. This is a phenomenon that it's nothing new, but in 2023, five young teenagers lost their lives while subway surfing. Already this year in Brooklyn, we had a teenager lose his life in Brooklyn. So what we've learned, and we're attacking this problem from all different angles, you know, enforcement-wise, outreach-wise, and this train, I just took a tour of this train. It's a beautiful train, and what's different from this train versus what's out there already, particularly the trains that these kids are subway surfing are, is how are they getting on top of the train? And lots of times they're getting to the top of the train and back down in between the train cars. So as you'll soon see, this train doesn't offer them the exit or the entry that the other ones do. So it's, in my opinion, if you're asking me, it's a safer car when it's talking subway surfing.
All right, we gotta move this along because the train needs to run on time, everybody. So thank you, and we're going to give you all a ride on the new train, first ride. Thank you.
Picture like the floor tiling.